This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream. Check out the extended version of this video by signing up for CuriosityStream and Nebula. Hey y'all, welcome back to the channel. Today we're talking about a really cool paper that came out last week where researchers showed that you can use neural activity from people imagining handwriting to actually decode letters, words, and even sentences. And before I get too far into this video, I should probably say that this is not something that will be available to the general public unless implanting electrodes in your brain is something that you like to do for fun, in which case do you, and also I'm not a doctor and you should probably talk to one. So let's not waste any time and dive into the paper. Today we're talking about this paper from Stanford researchers called High Performance Brain-to-Text Communication via Handwriting. And in this paper, the researchers were interested in investigating whether complex gestures or motor functions like handwriting can be decoded from our neural activity. And this is because a lot of past work in brain-computer interface research has shown that larger gestures such as grasping for things can actually be decoded from our neural activity. If you're interested in learning more about this, the brain gate trials are a great place to start. But more complicated movements, things like handwriting where you're moving a bunch of small muscles and it takes a bunch of small gestures in order to complete an action, would be harder to pull out of neural data because it's just a much more complex movement, at least in theory. But it turns out that you can do that specifically by using dimensionality reduction techniques and machine learning to decode neural signals and link them to words. So here you can see the setup for this experiment where a paralyzed person was asked to imagine themselves writing different letters, in this case, preparing to write an A and then preparing to write an M. And what the researchers did was take the neural activity from the Utah arrays, which are the electrodes implanted in their brains, in two different regions related to motor function, and perform a method called principal component analysis, which essentially takes your data and extracts the components that have the highest amount of variance. The goal of PCA here is to extract the neural signals associated with the handwriting and not things like background noise or other things that might not be relevant to our task. From here, they essentially align the data to make it easier to work with, and then they use this really interesting technique to actually reconstruct the characters that were drawn in the person's brain. And if you want to learn more about that, you should check out the Nebula Plus version of this video. But what you can see from these images is that this does look like the alphabet and looks like standard alphanumeric characters, which is pretty cool. They also performed a method called T-SNE on the data, which is another dimensionality reduction technique to show the data can be clustered into different groups representing different letters so that the data is separable. We can reliably distinguish neural activity associated with, for example, an M from activity associated with a D. So this is already pretty cool, but from here the researchers were interested in seeing if they could decode entire sentences instead of just letters and do so in real time. And they did this by using a recurrent neural network or an RNN to process the data within a certain window of time and assign a probability of that data being associated with any particular letter based on those embeddings that we saw earlier. Interestingly, they did this in two different ways. So in the real-time system, they essentially used a thresholding system where if the probability of a certain set of data being a certain letter was high enough, then it was assigned that letter, and that was what was used in the sentence. But they also implemented an autocorrect feature. The autocorrect feature used a language model to essentially fix any errors by predicting the probability that a letter came next in a sequence of letters, so that once we had the probability data from a particular window of neural activity, we could figure out whether the letter with the highest probability was actually likely to be the next letter in the sentence. For example, in the paper, they show a sequence of characters that are supposed to say the paper, and in the thresholding approach, we would see an error where the H in the is replaced with an N. However, using the language model, we can see that the more likely subsequent letter is actually H, and you end up with a corrected sentence. And as you can see, as the patient continued to do this task repeatedly, continue to imagine letters and have the computer process them, they were able to type faster, so type more characters per minute over the course of each trial day. So there are a lot of other interesting parts of this paper, including the daily decoder retraining section, which focuses on seeing what happens essentially when you retrain the handwriting decoder with new data every single day. And the reason why we do this is because our baseline neural signals actually change day over day. So you can actually see this in the supplementary figures where the representation of different letters changes day over day. And that has to be accounted for when you make models like this, because if the signals look one way one day and look a different way a different day, then your model won't actually work in the long term or really in the short term. And as one might expect, they found that depending on the delay between patient experiments, so if you wait 2 to 7 days between experiments, 8 to 14 or 15 to 37 days, if you don't retrain the model at all, your error rate goes up a lot. Interestingly though, it doesn't take that much data to get the error rate back down to what it was before, as you can see from this figure. Now, this paper shows results from one study participant who already had a system implanted in his brain that would allow for this kind of research. So we'll have to see more studies on this kind of work to see how well this generalizes, but it's certainly a very interesting finding and has a lot of positive implications for the future of brain-computer interfaces as it relates to conditions like paralysis. Additionally, I found it really interesting because there's been a lot of recent interest in how our brains represent the things that we encounter in our lives. So there was another paper that I saw on Twitter that showed that our brain actually represents different tools as different neural activity in our brains, which is like pretty cool. And developing both clinically translatable and just generally useful brain-computer interfaces will depend on us being able to decode more of these signals in a way that is useful for people. In fact, I've been pretty interested in doing some videos on consumer neurotechnology, so things like the stuff that I'm showing up here to test it and tell you guys how well it works. So if that's something you'd be interested in, let me know in the comments. But if you'd like to see a deeper dive into the technical details of how this brain-computer interface works, you should check out the Nebula Plus version of this video. If you're new to my channel, Nebula is a creator-built platform where you get to watch my videos ad-free, and some of your favorite creators, including myself, can create and experiment with awesome content without having to worry about demonetization or paying tribute to the YouTube algorithm. We're thrilled to be partnering with CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service with thousands of documentaries and nonfiction videos. Want to learn more about the ways that we can use machine learning to decode our brains? Check out the Brain Factory to learn more about how researchers are trying to upload our brains to digital avatars. And where CuriosityStream is all about big budget nonfiction documentaries, we're building Nebula so that education-y creators have a place to test out content that might not work well on YouTube. On Nebula, you'll find ad-free videos from some of your favorite creators, from Marques Brownlee to Neurotransmissions to Tirzu, and my Nebula Plus content, which includes extended versions of the videos you see on my channel. You'll also find Nebula originals like Tom Scott's Game Show Money or a very good trivia show where I won $500 for drawing a really nice circle. CuriosityStream loves independent creators and wants to help us grow our platform, so if you click on the link in the description or use my promo code Jordan, you can get access to CuriosityStream for 26% off their annual plans, with Nebula included for free for as long as you are a CuriosityStream member. That's less than $15 a year. Signing up for CuriosityStream is a great way to directly support my channel while getting to watch my videos ad-free and getting access to my Nebula Plus content. So sign up for CuriosityStream and Nebula at curiositystream.com/Jordan or using the promo code Jordan. Otherwise, if you like this video, you can let me know by smashing the like button and subscribing to my channel. You can also check out videos that I've done on Neuralink if you want to learn more about brain-computer interfaces. If you want to follow my PhD life, you can do so on Twitter and Instagram, and I'll see y'all next week. Bye!